أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم وجعلنا منهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا لما صبروا وكانوا بآياتنا يوقنون صلوات بليز. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the tawfiqat to attend this Viladat anniversary of our 10th Imam, Imam Ali al-Naqi al-Hadi alayhi salatu wa salam. Keeping in mind that, you know, today was the first day after a very busy, long weekend in Toronto. It was the first day of the school. And so even for you to think about tonight and participate in the viladat of the imam of one of the imams of Ahlul Bayt is a sign of your devotion and love. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all and all those who are watching from far away. Salawat. Because I get the complaint that you only pray for those whom you see. You don't pray for those who are watching you online. So inshallah, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever reason is that, you know, you are not here, may Allah bless you also. I recited ayat number 24 from Surah Al-Sajda, which in a general sense, there is a specific meaning of that in the context of the ayat, but there is a general import and the meaning of that, which is about this process of leadership that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, has devised for the human society. And he uses this term, ja'alna, ja'ala, ja'iluna, ja'ilun, you know, in different ways, where he says, I have taken this right on myself to appoint the imams. Nobody else has a right to do that. When it came to the story of Adam alayhi salam, he says, Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. When it comes to Ibrahim alayhi salam, he says, Waj'alnaka imaman. And so it's nowhere in the Quran, not a single case in the Quran where when it comes to leadership in form of a Nabi or a Rasul or those who were the Khulafa and the successor, the Awsiya and the Awliya of the Anbiya, there is not a single case where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has delegated that right to anyone else. And this is a very general statement where he says, وَجَعَلَّ مِنْهُمْ, that from among the people and the communities, we have appointed أَئِمَّةً, imams and guides and leaders, to do what? The name of the term imam itself is clear. Imam is the one who guides. And so the function is yahduna bi amrina. They guide according to our command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why did Allah choose some and not the others? This is the only ayat where he gives a kind of a preference why he chose some people and not the others. He says, لما صبروا وكانوا بآياتنا يوقنون. Two things. He says, I saw in them two, you know, qualities as a potential. One was sabr, to have patience in fulfilling their duty as leaders. And number two, they had total yaqin and conviction in the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There were no raib and doubt or any shubha in their beliefs. And when we look at that, we see that one of the imams, you know, who would come in that list under this general statement of the ayat of Quran is our 10th imam, Imam Ali al-Naqi alayhi salatu wasalam. His famous title besides al-Naqi is al-Hadi. Al-Hadi means somebody who does hidayat, guide. And so that title is very much, you know, fitting with this ayat of Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. When we look at this position of imamat, and I've talked about it many, many times, when the leader and the guide is appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then age and maturity does not matter at all. whether they are baligh or non-baligh. They are, you know, in the early stage of their life or a later stage of the life. That doesn't matter, because they have been appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you look at the example of Imam Ali Naqi as well as his father, Imam Muhammad Taqi, you will see that their imamate started when they were not yet 10 years old. This is very, you know, unprecedented in the Shi'i history. All the imams before, their imamate started when they were, most of them, you know, towards the 30s. But when it came to these two imams, for us, this is an issue I talked about it many times. I don't want to repeat that. So it doesn't matter, because Allah has chosen them. He equips them with the knowledge and the wisdom and the way to guide. They don't need to go to a school. They don't need to go and become graduates of a university. They don't need to go through the process of experience. Everything is given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so let me come to an issue which I would like to talk about it tonight, is that an imam at the age of 8 or 9 or, you know, 10, what is the source of their knowledge? And even the imams were before. They're not given, gone to any madrasa or a hawza or a school or a university. So what was the source of the knowledge of the imams of Ahlul Bayt? Basically, in our theology, in our aqidah, you get two sources about it. Number one, the Ahadith of the Prophet. That is a very important source of knowledge of the imams who came after the Prophet. Now, these Ahadith were either transmitted directly, for example, in case of Amir al-Mu'minin and Imam Hassan and Hussein, because they, salawat, they had seen the Prophet, so they could directly say that this is what the Prophet had said, or through the previous imams. So when you come to, for example, sixth imam, you know, he would say, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمُ so-and-so. You know, people will ask him, well, you didn't see him. And the sixth imam actually said, whenever I say قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ and I don't give you a source, you can assume I heard it from my father, who heard it from his father, who heard from his father, who heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the first source of the knowledge of the imams, at whatever age they would be, are the prophetic ahadith, al-ahadith al-nabawiyya, you know, which they have come to inherit directly or through the previous imams. The second source is ilham. Ilham means divine inspiration, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, gives that knowledge to them in their heart and their mind, you know, without sending any angel as such. They would hear things but not see an angel. You know, that process of wahi ended with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there is no wahi and revelation after the Prophet of Islam. But the door of ilham, divine inspiration, is still open. You know, when we say that about the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, you know, our other Muslim brothers say, oh, you are elevating their status to the prophethood. No. You read the Quran, you will see examples of people who are not from the Anbiya or Mursaleen, yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent, you know, inspiration to them. You have the example of Khizr. Khizr is not a confirmed Nabi in any, you know, perspective, Shia or Sunni. Even those who include him there, they put a question mark there because they are not sure about it. But he was somebody who had been blessed with knowledge. That even Musa alayhi salam and Ulul Azm prophet had to go to him. Then you have the example of Asif bin Barqiyya, the wazir of Prophet Sulaiman. He had been given the knowledge. He had, you know, ilmun min al-kitab, according to the words of the Quran. He had the knowledge of a portion of the divine book. And so, and he was not a Nabi, he was a wazir of the Nabi. and even the mother of Prophet Musa alayhi salam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to her, don't worry about your child. We inspired to her that, you know, put your child in the basket, in the river. We will take care of him and we will bring him back to you. So this is ilham coming to the mother of Musa. She is not a Nabi or a Rasul. So ilham is not the basically exclusive preserve of the Anbiya and the Mursaleen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can choose that for whomever he wants. And our imams are among the chosen one. In the books that we have, they are known actually as muhaddas. Muhaddas means the malaika talk to them. They don't see the malaika, but they are able to hear the malaika. And the knowledge that they get is not acquired from other human beings. And therefore, it is known as ilm al-ladunni, the knowledge given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat alaykum wa rahmatullah. Tonight, I will just give you two examples about our 10th Imam. One is the example of the prophetic hadith that he narrated, just to give you an idea of how, you know, imams sometimes when they give statements, they are based on the ahadith of the Prophet. And the other is from the example of ilham, divine inspiration. One that I have here basically is an incident narrated by al-Mas'udi, a famous early historian of the world of Islam, and he's known to be among the Shias. Here's a narration from Muhammad bin al-Faraj al-Rukhji. Muhammad bin al-Faraj was a close companion of our 10th Imam, and he was trusted by the Imam. Actually, Muhammad bin al-Faraj died in the lifetime of the 10th Imam, and when he became ill, the Imam, Imam Ali al-Hadi, actually sent his shirt or his robe to him. And Muhammad al-Faraj actually used to keep it under his head or under the pillow during the time of his illness. And when he died, that shirt was used to make his coffin. This example, although it's not first time that we've seen the example of the imams, even in case of Imam Rida alayhi salam, there is an example with a famous poet, Da'bal, who asked the Imam that I would like to get a shirt that you have used for myself as a barakat. This is where we see that, you know, when we talk about the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, they are not just ordinary human beings. They are human beings, but they are not ordinary human beings. They are insan, no doubt about it. They are bashar, no doubt about it. They are not God. They are not God. But they have something that others don't have. You know, a shirt used by them, or which has been in the proximity or in touch with their body, has a value which is not there in the thousands and millions of shirts that you see around the world. And that is because of, you know, being touched by the body of the Masoom Imam. It has this barakah in it, and this is where we have this concept of tabarrukat from the masumeen. And so Muhammad al-Faraj al-Rukhji actually narrates a statement from Abu Du'ama, who says that ataytu Ali ibn Muhammad alayhi salam a'idan fi illatihi allati kanat wafatuhu minha. Abu Du'ama says that when our 10th Imam became ill from the poison given by the Khalifa of the time, and this is where it ended in his wafat. He says, I went to visit the Imam. Now, you know, this process of ayadat is very common. So he says, when I visited the Imam, sat down with him, فَلَمَّا هَمَمْتُ بِالْإِنْصِرَافِ قَالَ لِي. He says, when I decided to then take his leave, Imam, you know, he spoke to me and he says, Ya Aba Du'ama, قَدْ وَجَبَ عَلَيَّ حَقُّكَ. You know, when we talk about ayadat, this issue of visiting the people who are not feeling well, the sick people, this is a very highly, you know, recommended deed in Islam. If you know a mu'min, a believer whom you know and they are not feeling well, one of the haq that that person would have on you is that you go and visit that person. And there is great merit in it. But it's interesting here that Imam says that you came to visit me. You fulfilled your duty. But because you came to visit me, wajib alayya haqqaka. Now, it is wajib on me in a way, not in a fiqhi way, but in an akhlaqi way, that I should fulfill your haqq. I should do something in return. Now, when we talk about, you know, appreciating the visit by somebody who is coming to visit you for illness, it doesn't have to be in form of material or monetary nature. Yes, we would like to, you know, offer chai for somebody who is visiting you. That's good. That is, in a way, you are, you know, appreciating his visit. But here, Imam actually talks about a different thing. He says, now that it has become wajib on me to fulfill your haq, أَلَا أُحَدِّسُكَ بِحَدِيثٍ تَصُرُّ بِهِ. In return, I would like to narrate a hadith for you, which will make you happy. And this is where, you know, Abu Du'ama says, مَا أَحْوَجَنِي إِلَىٰ ذَلِكِ يَبْنَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. He says, you know, what could be more needful or useful to me than that? I don't want any dirham or dinar from you. You know, yes, I'll take the hadith that you would like to give me. And this is where then the Imam starts, you know, reciting that. And I would like to read the whole thing where he says, حدثني أبي محمد بن علي. Imam, you know, Ali al-Hadi says, Ali al-Naqi, that my father Muhammad bin Ali narrated to me, and he said, حدثني أبي علي بن موسى. My father said that his father narrated to me, and that is Ali ibn Musa Raza, قال, who said, حدثني أبي موسى بن جعفر. He says, narrated to me my father, Musa ibn Ja'far, Musa al-Kazim here, and he said, حدثني أبي جعفر بن محمد. And he said that my father, Ja'far bin Muhammad al-Sadiq, narrated to me, who said, حدثني أبي محمد بن علي. He says, you know, my father, Muhammad al-Baqir, narrated to me, and he said, حدثني أبي علي بن الحسين. And he says, you know, narrated to me my father, Ali ibn Hussein Zain al-Abidin, who said, حدثني أبي الحسين بن علي. Then narrated to me my father, Hussein bin Ali, who said, حدثني أبي علي بن أبي طالب, who says, you know, narrated to me my father, Ali bin Abi Talib, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. And then he says, what did Ali say? قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Ali says that رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم said, يا علي اكتب. وعلي write down. فقلت وما اكتب. Ali said, what should I write down? And this is where, you know, the Prophet says, اكتب, write down. It's just a very short hadith from the Prophet. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Al-Iman wa ma waqqaratuhu al-qulub wa saddaqatuhu al-amal. Wal-Islam ma jara 'ala al-lisan wa hallat bihi al-manakih. The Prophet is defining Iman and Islam. And he's showing the difference. He says, write down that Iman, true faith and belief, is what is settled in the hearts. The place of residence of the Iman is the heart of a mu'min. وَصَدَّقَتْهُ الْأَعْمَالِ. And if it's truly there, it will be proven by the actions that you do. So iman is basically the two things here. One is that it resides in the heart, and it is proven by the actions of the mu'min. Wal Islam, whereas Islam ma jara ala al-lisan. Islam is what is, you know, uttered by the tongue. وَحَلَّتْ بِهِ الْمَنَاكِحِ. And because of that kalima of shahada, you know, relationships with the Muslim community become halal. A person becomes a member of the community. This is where we have to realize that there is a difference between Islam. Islam resides on the tongue. Iman resides in the heart. And a true mu'min has to show his iman by manifestation of the good deeds that he does apparently. Whereas Islam has only to do with becoming a member of the ummah. And it's good that Imam mentions, you know, وَحَلَّتْ بِهِ الْمَنَاكِهِ. There is another definition. This is the hadith of the Prophet, where other mentioned things are mentioned also, you know, his food would be halal for you, and his park and things like that. And this is where we see, but the Imam connects immediately here in the hadith of the Prophet with marriage. So if somebody, a non-Muslim, comes to me and he says, I want to say the shahadatain, I can't open his heart and see he is true or not, or he's sincere or not. I don't have a duty to do that. I don't have the ability to do that. So I will just accept his words. And once he says the shahadatain, those who brought him to my office will say, Maulana, now we want to do the nikah. I don't have a choice but to do the nikah there, to recite the aqad, because now we already assessed the shahadatain. And this is where Islam basically is a matter of tongue. But when it comes to iman, iman is a matter which resides in the heart. And sometimes it takes years for that Islam to reach from the tongue and settle down in the heart. You know, and this is a reality that we have to think about it. And the main thing is that if you have the true iman, صدقته الأعمال, it must manifest in form of the good deeds which are wajib in Islam. Salawat alaikum wa rahmatullah. And that is why we see, for example, when it comes to the introduction of Amir al-Mu'mineen by the Prophet in different ways, you will never see Ali been described as Amir al-Muslimin. What is he described as? Amir al-Mu'mineen. Because being Amir al-Muslimin is just a worldly thing. But the main issue for Ali is the issue of, he is the Amir al-Mu'mineen. And that is why the Prophet says, if you really want to test the iman of somebody, you have to see whether he has the hub towards Ali or bughs towards Ali. So the love and hatred towards Ali becomes a way of knowing the iman of a person. Salawat pranay ikbar. So Imam Ali Naqi al-Hadi here gives a gift in appreciation for this visit and iyadat that Abu Du'ama has done to him. And this is the hadith with the sanad, his narration, all the way from his father to grandfather to great-grandfather, going one generation back, all the way to the Prophet. Abu Du'ama responded in a very beautiful way. He says, Ya ibn Rasulullah, وَاللَّهِ مَا أَدْرِ أَيُّهُمَا أَحْسَنَ. He says, oh, the son of the Prophet, I don't know which is the better of the other. Al-Hadith أَمِ الْإِسْنَادِ. Is the hadith itself a good one, or is the names in the sanad and the chain of narration that you have which is better than the other? Salawat pranayak. And so we see this, even this is in another case of another imam where a similar example has been mentioned by Imam Raza alayhi salam, where one of the four a'imma of the madahib of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, who actually made a comment. He says, you know, let alone this hadith of Rasulullah that Imam Raza alayhi salam has quoted, just look at the names which have come before in the chain of narration. These are so powerful that if you recite that as a dua on somebody who is mentally ill, you know, he can be cured of his lunacy. Salawat pranay. And then Imam mentioned something, Imam Ali al-Naqi al-Hadi, when Abu Du'ama said that I don't know whether the hadith itself is good or the names in the chain of narration is better. And Imam says, where did I get this from? And this is, I'm coming to my point, that the first source of the knowledge of the Imams is the prophetic ahadith. He says, إِنَّهَا لَسَحِيفَةُ. This is from the scroll, the book, or the notebook, بِخَطِّ عَلِي بِنْ أَبِي طَالِبِ, which has been written in the handwriting of Ali bin Abi Talib, وَإِمْلَاءِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, and dictated by Rasulullah. So this was a very common thing that Rasulullah would dictate things to Ali, and Ali would write it down. And this was a book which was inherited after Ali by Hassan, then Hussein, and went on from one imam to another, till we come to the 10th imam, and he says, نَتَوَارِسُهَا صَاغِرًا أَنْ كَابِرٌ. Each one of us, one descendant would inherit from the other one, the ancestor who had came before. And we see till the 10th imam, that book, Kitabu Ali, or Sahifatu Ali, existed, and Imam talks about it. And this is where we believe that, you know, it was later on inherited by the 11th Imam, and then now it is in the possession of Imam of the time, Ajalallahu Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif. So that was one example of what we talk about, this source of the knowledge of the Imams, and that is from the prophetic ahadith, narrated to them from their ancestors. Another example which I would like to share here is the issue of ilham, divine inspiration. And this is an honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has only given to those who are the chosen ones. And one of the dimensions of this ilham is that they have the ability, if they want, to know the thoughts in the minds of the people before that person would even mention and describe it to the imam. And there are many, many examples from many imams on this issue, but this one is from the 10th imam. And here the narration is from a person by the name of Abu Ishaq bin Abdullah al-Halawi al-Uraizi, where he says that حك في صدري ما لأيام التي تصام. He says, a thought came to my mind, in my heart, in my mind. What are the main important days that we have to fast? And so, of course, he's not talking about Ramadan. He's talking about recommended days of fasting. فقصدت مولانا أبو الحسن علي بن محمد وهو بصريا. He says, then I went. In order to get this answer, I went to visit Imam Ali ibn Muhammad al-Naqi, and he was in the area known as Sarya. And then he says, this person is very clear about it. He says, وَلَمْ أُبْدِي ذَلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ مِّنْ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ. He says, I didn't mention what I had in my mind to anyone from the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I didn't mention it to anyone at all. فَدَخَلْتُ عَلِيهِ. Then I went, got the permission, went inside. فَلَمَّا بَصُرَ بِي, when the Imam saw me, before even I say anything, Imam started speaking to me, and he says, يَا أَبَا إِسْحَاقُ, O Abu Ishaq, جِئْتَ تَسْعَلُونِي عَنِ الْأَيَّامِ الَّتِي يُصَامُ فِيهِنَّ. You have come to me in order to ask from me the important days that you have to fast, recommended. وَهِيَ أَرْبَعَ. There are four important days that Imam here singles out from a long list that we have. أَوَّلُهُنَّ يَوْمَ الصَّابِ وَالْعِشْرِينِ مِنْ رَجَبْ. The first one is the 27th of Rajab. It is the day بعث الله تعالى محمدًا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. This is the day when the Prophet, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised the Prophet to that level, to the people, as rahmatun lil alameen, as a mercy for the world. And the second one, wa yawma mawlidihi, and the second is the day of his birth, of the imam, of the Prophet. And which day is that? Wa huwa sabi'ashar min shahr rabil awwal. The 17th of the Rabi al-Awwal. Number third, wa yawm al-khamis wal-ishreen min dhil qa'da. The third day of importance as far as recommended fasting is concerned, he says, the 25th of the month of dhil qa'da, which is known as the day of Dahiyul Arab, the day when, you know, the earth was first covered by water totally. Even the scientists agree with that. Then gradually the water, you know, started to diminish and the land appeared. The first point where the you know, earth appeared is the land on which you see the Kaaba today. And that is the 25th of the month of the Zilqa'da, and it's recommended to fast on that day. And the fourth day, and this is relevant to us, the day is coming very soon. The 10th Imam says the 10th important day of fasting is وَيَوْمُ الْغَدِيرِ, the day of Ghadir. فِيهِ أَقَامَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أَخَاهُ عَلِيًّا عَلَمًا لِلنَّاسِ. On this day, the Prophet actually raised, you know, his brother Ali as a, you know, very clear sign to the people. وَإِمَامًا مِنْ بَعْدِهِ, and appointed him as the Imam afterwards. And this is where Abu Ishaq says, صَدَقْتَ جُعِلْتُ فِدَاكَ, you are indeed true. I came to you for this specific question. And now I affirm my belief. أَشْحَدُ عَنَّكَ حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى خَلْقِهِ, I affirm my belief that you indeed are the proof of Allah among the people. Salawat. The 10th Imam, you know, so we saw the example of the prophetic ahadith inherited by the Imams and the ilham. You know, how would he know that what is in the mind of this person who has come to see me, other than saying that Allah gave him that ability to know, and this is inspiration, this is ilham. The timing of our Imams, Imamate is very close to the time of Ghaybat, of the 12th Imam, and Imam actually was preparing the community. And whenever he got the opportunity, he would talk about the 12th Imam and the Ghaybat that he's going to go through. There is a very beautiful narration that we have from Abdul Aziz al-Hassani. Abdul Aziz, you know, those of you who have gone for ziyarat in Iran, before you go to Qom, in the southern part of Tehran, there is a small town by the name of Shah Abdul Aziz. Shah Abdul Azim. It's known by that name because that is the shrine of Abdul Azim. He was one of the descendants of the Imams, and he was contemporary of the 9th and the 10th Imam. Probably he even saw the 11th Imam. And he came from that area of Ray, you know, Tehran, which was the old name of the city was Ray. And he was one of the frequent, you know, visitors to the Imam. He says, one day I came to the Imam, and when Imam saw me, of course, they are also related, they are from the same family. Imam welcomed him by saying, Marhaba bika ya Abu al-Qasim, anta waliyuna haqqan. Welcome, welcome Abu Qasim, you are a true friend of ours. You know, it's different for us to say we are Shia of Ali, and Ali accepting us as his Shia. This is where the Imam is saying to this fellow that you are a true Wali of us. And so he says, Ibn Rasulullah, I've come to you just to make sure I'm on the right path. I would like to, you know, present to you what are my basic beliefs, so that if it is acceptable, then I'll stay on that till the day I die. So Imam said, say, go ahead. Say what you want to say. And so he says that my belief is that in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wahidun laysa kamithlihi shay kharijun min al-haddain haddul ibtal wa haddut tashbih. You know, all these needs very elaborate discussion. We can have seminars about it, but I'm just going very quickly through it. He talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. He says that I believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, there is nothing like him, and he is beyond the level of description. You cannot describe him like anything, nor can you say that he is so high and great that we cannot even describe him. Basically, we describe him the way he has described himself. And then he says, وَلَيْسَ بِجِسْمٍ وَلَا صُورَةٍ وَلَا أَرْضٍ وَلَا جَوْهَرٍ. He is not to be seen in any, you know, physical form at all. He is the one who created the physical forms. He is the one who created the faces of the people. He is the one who created everything. وَرَبَّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَمَالِكُهُ وَجَاعِلُهُ وَمُحَدِّسُهُ. He is the one who created and he is the Lord of everything. Then he says, my second important belief is that إِنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَخَاتِمُ النَّبِيِّينَ. That Muhammad is his servant, and his messenger, and the last of the prophets. لا نبي بعده إلى يوم القيامة. There is no Nabi after him. وإن شريعته خاتم الشرايع. His Sharia is the final one. There is no Sharia to come after that. So those people who would like to dilute it, change it, make halal into haram and haram into halal, they should know this is the last, you know, Sharia. You are not a Nabi or an Imam to change it. Number three, he says, after talking about Allah and Rasul, then he says, وَعَقُولُ إِنَّ الْإِمَامُ وَالْخَلِيفَةُ وَوَلِيُّ الْعَمْرِ بَعْدُهُ. The Imam and the Khalifa and the person in authority after Rasulullah is Amir al-Mu'minin Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salam. And then he goes on to narrate the names, ثُمَّ الْحَسَنُ ثُمَّ الْحُسَيْنُ ثُمَّ عَلِي بْنُ حُسَيْنُ ثم محمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي. And then he comes to the Imam. وأنت يا مولاي. And you, محمد بن علي. This is why I'm saying the Imam is now preparing him for the future. Here, you know, Abdul Azim stops. And Imam now continues. ومن بعدي الحسن ابني. You come to me. But remember that after me, my son Hassan, Hassan al-Askari would be the Imam. وَكَيْفَ النَّاسِ بِالْخَلَفْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. And what about the people? What will be their attitude about my son's son? Who will come after him? This is the 12th Imam. And so Abdul Azim says, وَكَيْفَ ذَلِكَ يَا مَوْلَايِ. Why do you talk about people having different views? He says, people will have different views about my grandson. لِأَنَّهُ لَا يُرَى شَخْصُهُ. Because people will not see him physically. وَلَا يَحِلُّ ذِكْرُهُ بِإِسْمِهِ. And during that time, it's not for all the time, but the time when there was danger, and especially in Ghaybat al-Sughra, it was not permissible to mention him by his name. حَتَّى يَخْرُجَ فَيَمْلَعَ الْعَرْضَ قِسْطًا وَعَدْلًا كَمَا مُلِعَتْ جَوْلًا. He says, until he makes his appearance and fills the earth with equality and justice, just as it would be filled at that time with injustice and tyranny. And so Abdul Azim says, I agree and accept it. So although he is not yet seen, it's not the time of the imamat of the 11th imam or 12th imam, but he says, this is the complete iman and aqeedah that I have. Salawat from him. And so then he ends, he says, I believe, أَنَّ وَلِيُّهُمْ وَلِيُّ اللَّهِ. The one who is a friend of the Imams is the friend of Allah. وَعَدُوُّهُمْ عَدُوُّ اللَّهِ. And the enemy of them, the Imams, is the enemy of Allah. طَاعَتُهُمْ طَاعَةُ اللَّهِ. To obey the Imams is to obey Allah. وَمَعْصِيَتُهُمْ مَعْصِيَةُ اللَّهِ. And to disobey the Imams is to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He goes on to say, I believe in the mi'raj haqqun, that the mi'raj of Rasulullah was haqq and the truth. Wal mas'ala fil qabri haqqun, and the questioning by the angels in the grave is haqq. Wa anna al-jannata haqqun wal nara haqqun, and I believe in Jannah and And Jahannam also, والصراط حق, the sirat in the day of judgment would be حق, والميزان, and the scale would be حق, وعن نسات عاتية لا ريب فيها, and the doom's hour will come for sure, وإن الله يبعث من في القبور, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect the people who are buried in the graves. And then he ends by saying, إن الفرائض واجبة بعد الولاية, the duties which are wajib on us after the wilayat of Ahlul Bayt, as-salat, wal-zakat, wal-sawm, wal-hajj, wal-jihad, wal-amr bil-ma'roof, wal-nahy al-munkar. I don't need to translate that. And this is where, you know, Imam now says to him, Ya Abul Qasim, haza billahi deenullah. O Abul Qasim, referring to Abdul Azim, that this is indeed the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, irtadahu li'ibad, and he has chosen it so that people may worship him through it. فثبت عليه ثبتك الله بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا والآخرة. And so stay firm on it, and may Allah keep you firm on it in this dunya as well as in the akhirah. Salawat. امام کے زندگی سے بس دو مثالیں ہمیں دینی تھی کہ ائمہ کے علم کا سورس کیا ہے. ایک احادیث نبوی ہے اور ایک الہام ہے جو خداوند عالم کی طرف سے ان پہ وارد ہوتا ہے. امام کے جو آخری بیان کو ہم نے آپ کے سامنے پیش کیا ہے کہ امام کمیونٹی کو غیبت کے زمانے کے لیے تیار کر رہے تھے. وکالت کا سسٹم آلریڈی نوے امام نے اسٹیبلش کر دیا, and that continued during the days of the 10th Imam and 11th Imam and in Ghaybat Sughra. Lekin ek aur waqia aapke samne, a very brief yani hadith hai ye ke Ghaybat Kubra mein guidance ka source kya hoga. Iski ek jhalak milti hai, indication hame milta hai ابو حماد الرازی سے. رازی یہ وہی لوگ ہیں جو شاہ عبدالعزیز کے ایریا کے رہنے والے ہیں, ان کو رازی بھی کہا جاتا ہے. شیخ کلینی بھی اسی ایریا کے تھے. ابو حماد کا کہنا ہے کہ ایک بار ہم جو ہیں سامرہ میں امام علی النقی الہادی علیہ السلام سے ملنے کے لیے گئے. فَسَأَلْتُهُ عَنْ عَشْيَاءٍ مِنَ الْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ, اور ان سے ملاقات کے بعد ہم نے کچھ کوشچنس کیے حلال و حرام کے بارے میں. فعجبنی فیہا, اور امام نے ہمارے تمام کوشچنس کا جواب دیا. فلما ودعته, لیکن جب ہم کھڑے ہوئے فیرویل کے لیے, خدا حافظی کے لیے, تو امام جانتے تھے کہ ہم کہاں کے رہنے والے ہیں, اسی ایریا کے ہیں جہاں کے عبدالعزیز ہیں, عبدالعظیم ہیں. تو امام اس سے کہتے ہیں, یا حماد, اذا اشكل عليك شيء من امر دينك بناهيتك, کہ اے حماد, جب تم اپنے شہر میں ہو, اپنے ریجن میں, علاقے میں ہو, اور کوئی دین کا کوئی بھی مسئلہ تمہارے لیے مشکل ہو جائے, فسل عنه عبد العظیم بن عبد الله الحسنی, تو جا کے عبد العظیم سے پوچھو, اور وہ بھی جو بھی جواب دیں گے اس پر تم عمل کرو. وأقرعه مني السلام, اور میرا سلام بھی عبد العظیم تک پہنچا. یہاں ہمیں کیا انڈیکیشن ملتا ہے؟ انڈیکیشن یہ مل رہا ہے کہ غیبت کے زمانے میں جب ہمارے لیے امام سے کانٹیکٹ, معصوم امام سے ممکن نہیں ہے, تو ہمیں کیا کرنا چاہیے؟ یہ نہیں ہے کہ ہماری ذمہ داری ختم ہو گئی, وی آر فری ٹو ڈو وٹ ایور وی وانٹ. نہیں, ہمیں رجوع کرنا پڑے گا ان لوگوں کی طرف جو صاحبان علم ہیں, جو ہمارے کمیونٹی کے بھروسے لوگ ہیں, صاحبان علم ہیں, جنہیں ہم لوگ مجتہد کہتے ہیں, ان کی طرف رجوع کریں گے. یہ ایگزامپل ایکچولی غیبت کا بھی نہیں ہے, یہ تو امام کے حضور کے زمانہ ہے. دسویں امام ابھی موجود ہیں, لیکن اب یہ کہہ رہے ہیں کہ تم اگر بہت دور ہو, یو کین ناٹ کم ٹو می سامرہ. ٹیلی فون بھی نہیں تھا اس زمانے میں, ای میل بھی نہیں تھا کہ کوئی امام کی ویب سائٹ ہو. ہاں, نو, دیر واز نتھنگ. تو اس کو اگر مسئلہ وہاں ہو رہا ہے تہران کے پاس, تو وہ کیا کرے گا؟ معطل ہو جائے گا, سسپینڈ کر لے گا اپنی زندگی کو. نہیں, Imam کہتے ہیں اس area میں فلاں آدمی ہے جس پر ہم بھروسہ کرتے ہیں جس نے ہم سے علم حاصل کیا ہے تم اس کے پاس جاؤ تو امام کے موجودگی میں بھی خود امام انڈیکیشن دے رہے ہیں کہ if you cannot come to me go to those who are expert تو یہ حضرات جو آج کل اجتہاد اور تقلید کے خلاف بولتے رہتے ہیں بہت ہی انٹلیکچول بن جاتے ہیں ذرا سوچیں کہ یہ باتیں جو ہیں یہ کوئی انوویشن نہیں ہے یہ بہت ہی نیچرل پروسیس ہے اور خود دسویں امام نے اپنے زمانے میں انڈیکیشن دیا ہے کہ اگر ہمارے دور میں بھی اگر ہم تک نہیں پہنچ سکتے ہو تو جا کے رجوع کرو ان لوگوں کی طرف جو صاحبان علم ہیں جو ہمارے لیے قابل بھروسہ ہیں جو ہمارے دین و مذہب اور ماننے والوں میں سے ہیں خداوند اس قلی بات قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خداوند ہمیں توفیق دے کہ ہم صحیح معنوں میں محمد آل محمد کے اس دین و مذہب پر قائم و دائم رہیں خداوند جہاں جہاں مسلمان ہیں ان کو اپنے حفظ و امان میں رکھ خصوصاً جو شیعان علی ہیں ان کو تکفیری افواج کی تمام مصیبتوں سے دور رکھ تکفیری افواج کو نیست و نابود فرما امام کے ظہور میں تعجیل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم